Hello, welcome dear students. We'll continue our lecture of physiology, lecture number 24, reproduction and endocrinology. Last time we have seen the structure of ovary, and in that we have seen how the ovum is developed from primary follicle, secondary follicle, then grown follicle, mature follicle, then graafian follicle, then how it releases by rupturing follicle, and how corpus luteum is formed up to the opening of hylus. Since opening of hylus to the end of opening of hylus, how the cycle is completed and ovum or female gamete is developed, that we have seen. Now we will see the structure of that gamete, how it develops. The structure of female matured graafian follicle, if we see the histological structure of this graafian follicle, then it is rounded and covered externally by a thick layer of cells known as theca externa. Then this theca externa is followed by theca interna or theca interstitial cells, which is the second most layer. Then the third layer is in theca externa, the basement lamina on which these cells are lying, and also connected by some loose connective tissues actually. And then theca interna is start from the internal wall. Inside this theca interna, membrana granulosa cells are there. These are very clearly mentioned and somewhat proliferated at the center from the lower side and forming a column like structure called a cumulus oophorus granulosa cells, and on which the cells, corona radiata cells or granulosa cells, are aggregating around the egg or developed ovum. Then in between these two, there is a zona pellucida layer which is around the egg or female gamete. In spite of these, there is a central open space, that space is called as antrum, or follicular fluid is there inside the fluid follicle. And meanwhile, there are some blood capillaries which are supplying blood to that, and some connective tissues are there. So this is the structure or histological architecture of the graafian follicle. Now this one, what we have seen about the structure of ovary and formation of ovum, but in oogenesis, what are the main changes takes place, that we will see. Oogenesis means formation of oud or egg, or in short, the process of formation of egg is called as oogenesis. This is the simple. Oogenesis means formation of egg takes place in the ovary of female animal. During oogenesis, the cells of germinal epithelium detached from the surface epithelium and enter the cortex of ovary. These germinal cells are diploid or 2n in number and are called primordial germ cells. These cells pass through the following three main phases to become the mature egg. In that, the germinal cells divide by meiosis, and these are diploid or 2n in number. So they are also undergo the phase of multiplication, phase of growth, and phase of maturation. In that, like spermatogenesis, in oogenesis, the phase of multiplication shows the primordial germ cell, which divides repeatedly by mitotic division, and form the egg mother cell or oogonia. Or we can say the cell which forms after process or development an egg or ovum. The oogonial cell divides repeatedly by mitosis and becomes primary oocytes, which then enter into a period of growth, and the growth is started after this multiplication. So they enter in the second phase called as growth phase. The growth phase plays an important role in oogenesis. In the growth phase, the size of oocyte increases enormously. Unbelievable growth is occur here. And for instance, the primary oocyte of the frog in the beginning has the diameter of about 50 mm. But after growth phase, the diameter of the mature egg reaches about 1000 mm to 2000 mm. The fully grown egg is always larger than average somatic cells in the animal and many times larger than the spermatozoon. The growth phase of oocytes may be divided into two sub stages. This structure is quite confusing. This might be micrometer, 50 micrometer. Actually 50 mm is so long. This might be the printing mistake, please take care. So the growth phase undergoes two stages or sub stages. First, pre-vitrogenesis. It is characterized by the tremendous increase in the volume of the nucleus and cytoplasm of the primary oocyte, which undergoes further for secondary oocyte, and this is called as growth of nuclear material or growth of cytoplasmic substances. And in these two, we also to see how the nuclear material or how the cytoplasmic material is developed. The nucleus of the oocyte increases in size due to the accumulation of large amount of nuclear sap and the nuclei of advanced oocytes. It becomes flood fluid. Such inflated nuclei are often referred to as germinal vesicle. However, there is no increase in the amount of DNA in proportion to the enlargement of the nucleus. The nucleus then undergoes meiosis and enters into the first prophase. The homologous chromosomes pair together and increase in length. The chromosomes of primary oocyte develop thin loop on the side which look like bottle brush. Because of the brush like appearance, the chromosomes are specially designed as lamp brush chromosomes. So as the structure of the chromosome is bottle brush like, so it is named as lamp brush chromosomes. And nucleolus also plays an important role in the synthetic activity taking place in the nucleus. The small nucleus may give rise to several nucleoli by fragmentation and budding. All these nucleoli come to lie near the nuclear membrane and they start to show the further development or growth. In second, this is about the nuclear material. In second, the cytoplasmic substances also shows the growth as the result, the volume of cytoplasm increases. Qualitative and quantitative changes in the cytoplasmic substances have been observed during this period. The mitochondria, which are fewer in number in young oocytes, are found to be increased remarkably during the growth phase. Example, in amphibians and birds or eels, the mitochondria aggregate to form mitochondrial clouds, and there is a special aggregation of the material around this growth phase of the cytoplasm. In young oocytes, the Golgi bodies occur around the centrosomes. As the oocyte matures, the Golgi bodies assume the form of large spherical mass, especially in some mammals, while in frogs and chick, they become distributed in the subcortical cytoplasm. In some animals, they totally disappear. So these might be the changes that express in the growth of the cytoplasmic substances or materials by aggregation of different cell organelles like centrioles, Golgi bodies and others, and shows growth of the substance. The endoplasmic reticulum, one of the cell organelles in young oocytes, is in the form of numerous small vesicles, while in mature oocytes, ER or endoplasmic reticulum appears as double membranous structure with no ribosomes. Means we can say it's a smooth type of endoplasmic reticulum. So next topic is vitellogenesis. Vitellogenesis involves the synthesis of yolk material to be stored in the ovum. The yolk contains, yolk means the yellow material of the egg. Upon pura barak muntondakla, that is nothing but the yolk. And the yolk contains reserve food. And that reserve food preparation or formation is nothing but the vitellogenesis. And the increase in volume of the oocyte during growth phase is largely due to the accumulation of yolk or nutritive substances in the egg cytoplasm. Regarding the actual site of vitellogenesis, or we call as synthesis of yolk material, there are two different views. And according to the first view, vitellogenesis takes place inside the oocyte itself, inside modified mitochondria. Example, amphibians and fishes are the best examples. They show vitellogenesis as a crystal clear mechanism. According to the second view, yolk is synthesized outside the ovary, and ready-made yolk is transported through the bloodstream to the oocyte. In most vertebrates, yolk is synthesized into the liver, and it is fat bodies in insects. Two kinds of yolk are generally distinguished, granular yolk and yolk platelets. Granular yolk occurs as fine granules which are more or less uniformly distributed in the cytoplasm of oocyte. Example, echinoderms, tunicates, brachiostoma, etc. In most vertebrates, fishes, amphibians, reptiles and birds, they show yolk granules are large and localized in the cytoplasm of the oocytes. Such large granules are called yolk platelets.
these are in two different types, that is granular and as well as platelets. So what is the role of follicle and nerve cells in oogenesis? That we will see here. In several group of animals, the growing oocytes are surrounded by special nutritive cells, follicle cells and nerve cells. So these are the structures basically and the role of the follicles. So they shows two different follicle cells and nerve cells. So what they do during the growth and maturation phase, the developing oocytes in the ovary of some vertebrates are surrounded by follicle cells, and the follicle cells establish contact with the oocyte through the fine canals called as desmosomes. The oocytes in turn develops fine finger-like processes called as microvilli, which interdigitate with those of the follicle cells. The various chemicals, macromolecules including yolk proteins entering the oocyte, pass through the desmosomes and microvilli. Thus the follicle cells helps in the growth of the oocyte. In this way, the follicle cells during the development or growth show the changes. Now the role of nerve cells, what they do in addition to these follicular cells? Special nutritive cells called as nerve cells are surrounding the growing oocyte of some of the invertebrates like annelids, insects and mollusks. The nerve cells are formed from the division of the oogonium. Means oogonium are divided meanwhile in the process, and the nerve cells are formed specially to support and take care of the oogonium forming cells. The nerve cells also assist in the growth of the oocyte. In Drosophila, this is a fruit fly. Now we have seen about some insects and annelids and mollusks. So we will see in Drosophila, the fruit fly, the oogonium undergoes 4 successive mitotic divisions and 16 cells are formed. Of these 16, only one develops into the oocyte and remaining transform into nerve cells and surrounding the oocyte, and they support the oocyte cells which further develop into the ovum or egg. And the third important phase is the phase of maturation. Here the growth phase is completed in this way, and in the phase of maturation, the maturation, or we can say meiotic division, the important cell division starts. In meiosis, hereafter the meiotic divisions of the nucleus, the cytoplasm of the oocyte, divides unequally to form a single large sized haploid egg and 3 small haploid polar bodies or polocytes at the end. This type of unequal division has the greater significance for the egg. If the equal divisions of the primary oocyte might have been resulted, the stored food amount would have been distributed equally to the 4 daughter cells, and which might prove insufficient for the developing embryo. And therefore, these three polar bodies are instead developing themselves, helps to support the one which develops fully and successfully. And these polar sites therefore shows unequal divisions and allowing only one cell out of four daughter cells to contain maximum cytoplasm, maximum reserve food and sufficient developing embryo, and this sufficient developing embryo further develops into a good quality animal. In that phase of maturation, we also observe two phases, that is phase of maturation, first maturation division and second meiotic division. In first meiotic division or maturation division, the first meiosis, homologous chromosomes of the primary oocyte nucleus pass through the pairing or synapsis, duplication, chiasma formation and crossing over. So these are the activities that takes place in the first division. Soon after, the nuclear membrane breaks and the bivalent chromosomes moves towards the opposite poles due to contraction of chromosomal fibers. A new nuclear envelope develops around the daughter chromosomes by the endoplasmic reticulum. After the karyokinesis, the unequal cytokinesis occurs and a small haploid polar body or ootid are formed. The polar bodies are generally called as ootids. So, second meiotic division. In second meiotic division, half the number of chromosomes are divided, that is haploid secondary oocyte and first polocyte pass through the second meiotic division. Due to the second meiotic division, the second oocyte forms a mature egg and a second polar body. By the second meiotic division, the first polocyte also divides into two secondary polocytes. Divides into two secondary polocytes, and these polocytes ooze out from the egg and degenerates, while the haploid egg cell becomes ready for the fertilization. And in this way, the maturation process is about to complete by the process of meiosis. Prior to that, divides mitotically. Out of 16, only one develops and remaining becomes polar bodies or ootids in the second or first or second maturation division or meiotic division. And in meiotic divisions, these bivalent chromosomes are divided into the half number of chromosomes or haploid chromosomes in the second, and at last the polocytes oozes out from the egg and degenerates, and haploid cell becomes the standard cell and ready for fertilization. Okay, see you. That's all for today.